Someday, sometime, you are going to come to your last night on earth. This is true no matter what your age is. The question is, when you come to your last night on earth, where are you going then? Stay tuned and find out from Bible prophecy what your destiny is.
The Steps to Life Prophecy Seminar will take you on a journey through the Bible, explaining prophecies and symbols that have confused men for centuries. Daniel, Revelation, the Beast, the Mark of Antichrist, the Mystery of Babylon. Grab your Bible and a pen as we turn the pages of God's Holy Bible.
Steps to Life is opening God's Word with you.
Jesus is coming again. Are you ready for His soon return?
Jesus Christ is always what we'll share with you.
We need a refreshing, so drink. Jesus is the water of life.
Steps to Life, a work of love, a work of love.
He created this earth and wants to recreate you.
He can change.
Thank you for joining us. In our last program, we studied about the great prophecy of Jesus in Matthew 24, in which He says before the end that there's coming a time when there will be a final generation in this world. Who and when is this final generation? That's what we have been studying. We're going to continue that study right now and find out about the final generation. But first, let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask Him to lead us and show us the truth in His Word by His Holy Spirit. Our Father in heaven, we thank You for Bible prophecy that teaches us the truth about the times in which we live and what is about to happen in this world as an overwhelming surprise. And we humbly but earnestly pray that Your Holy Spirit will teach us the truth of Your Word and help us to understand it and to live by it so that we will be ready. And we thank You in Jesus' name. Amen.
Welcome to the Steps to Life Prophecy Seminar. We would like to send you a free study pack, including a study guide and audio cassette of today's subject, as well as a free book entitled The End of the World. To receive your free gifts, simply call 1-800-THE-TRUTH. Have you ever wondered who Earth's final generation will be? What will be their experience? Is there any way to know when the end is coming? Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and request offer number 48. And now, Pastor John Grossbaugh.
In Matthew 24, Jesus gave to His disciples the great prophecy that ties together the prophecies in Daniel and Revelation and predicts what would happen, the significant major events that would happen between the time of His first advent and the time of His second coming. We have looked at some of these major events. We have seen in a previous program, Jesus made it very clear in Matthew 24 that sometime after the destruction of Jerusalem, which we know now occurred in 70 AD, that sometime after that there would be a great tribulation period in which Jesus said it would be a greater tribulation than there had ever been before. Now, when we look at the prophecies in Daniel and Revelation, we see that this period of great tribulation was to last over 1,000 years, namely 1,260 years. And at the end of this great tribulation period, we saw in a previous program that the devil was going to change his tactics. But as we approach the end of this great tribulation period, Jesus said that there were going to be signs, that He Himself was going to send signs in the heavens, signs that could not be contradicted. You read about this in Matthew 24:29. Jesus said, immediately after the tribulation of those days. We read it also from Luke 13. Jesus said it would be in those days, that is, in the days of the great tribulation, but after the tribulation was over. Jesus made it clear in Matthew 24 that the tribulation would be shortened, the great period of tribulation in which some people from the Society of Friends have said it was as many as 70 million. Others said it was maybe 50 million. Others say that it was much more than that. We will never know for sure how many Christians were burned to the stake, martyred in various ways, tortured to death, or in some way killed because of their belief in the Bible and following the teaching of the Bible. And this period of great tribulation extended until the end of the 1260-year prophecy, which ended in 1798. But Jesus said that in the days of that tribulation, before the tribulation period was over, but after the tribulation itself had actually ceased because it was to be shortened, he said immediately after that tribulation, there will be a dark day. The sun would not give its light, and the moon also, as we read in Matthew 24:29. We saw in a previous program that this dark day occurred on May 19, 1780. It has been referred to by many famous people since then. We referred to the fact that even John F. Kennedy referred to the dark day in 1780 in one of his political speeches. So it has been well known ever since that time. Before the dark day occurred, the book of Revelation revealed in Revelation the 6th chapter that before the dark day occurred, there would be a great earthquake, and then there would be a dark day, and the moon would be like blood, and the stars then would fall from heaven. In fact, in every place in the Bible, whether in the book of Joel, the book of Matthew, Mark, or Luke, or in the book of Revelation, where these signs are listed, they're always listed in the same order. Not all signs are listed in every place, but they're always given in the same order. We saw in a previous program that on November 1, 1755, the great earthquake did occur, called today the Lisbon earthquake, an earthquake that extended over about 4 million square miles. Remember, the whole 48 continental United States are less than 3 million square miles. That's a big area. That's a big earthquake. And then the dark day occurred in May 19, 1780. And men were seeing this, and they realized what was going on, and they read from the Bible, and they said, this is the sign. This is the sign that Jesus gave. And in the book of Luke 21, we read it. Jesus said, when you begin to see these signs, these latter-day signs, he said, then know that your redemption is starting to draw near. And so people began to study the Bible, and the result, they began to study what the Bible said about these signs of the second coming, the signs of the day of judgment. And a great second advent awakening occurred. Now, there was a misunderstanding, of course, as often happens to us human beings. They did not see the significance or the difference between the day of judgment and the second coming of Christ. They thought they were one and the same thing. Now, Revelation, the 14th chapter, verses 6 and 7, makes it very clear that the day of judgment begins when the gospel is still being preached in the world. It is in the last period of earth history, but the day of judgment begins when the gospel is still being preached in the world. But they didn't understand this. They thought that the day of judgment and the second coming were one and the same thing. And so when they preached about the day of judgment, which they did preach about the day of judgment, but they equated that with the second coming. And there were many, many Bible students that independently were studying their Bibles, and they came to the very same conclusion. We are just about at the day of judgment. And they equated the day of judgment with the second coming. One of these Bible students was a converted Jew by the name of Joseph Wolff. Now, Joseph Wolff became known as the missionary to the world. He went to many parts of the world and began to proclaim the Lord's soon coming. He believed that Jesus was going to come, that the day of judgment would begin, and they equated that with a second coming. He believed it would happen around 1844. There were many other reformers. There were many others who were saying the same thing in all parts of the world. For instance, in the British Isles, there were about 700 ministers of the Church of England who began to preach the same message. And in South America, a Spanish Jesuit named Lacunza began to preach the same message, and he wrote a clear exposition on the subject, which was translated into the English language and created quite a stir in England. And then in Germany, there was a Lutheran minister by the name of Bengel, and he taught the same truth. These reformers had all come to the same conclusions, independent of one another. Actually, Martin Luther had come to a similar conclusion. Here's what Martin Luther said in his time. He said, "I persuade myself verily that the day of judgment will not be full 300 years." Did you get it? Martin Luther said, "I believe the day of judgment will not be yet a full 300 years." And Martin Luther died in 1546. So that would be the 1830s, 1840s. Martin Luther believed too and did not understand, of course, the difference between the second coming of Christ and the day of investigative judgment that would precede it. Nowhere was this message given with more power and clarity than in America. And in America, God chose a humble farmer who was also a self-made and diligent scholar by the name of William Miller. Now, William Miller had been raised in a Baptist home, but he became, like many other early leaders in the United States, such as Jefferson and Franklin and Webster and others, he became a deist. That is, he believed there was a God who had at some time created the world, but then had left it to go and run on its own. He did not believe in miracles or in the prophecies of the Bible. As time went on, he became a successful farmer. He held a number of local political offices. He fought in the War of 1812. He began to realize the sinfulness and the emptiness of man. And he felt an emptiness within himself. He was a man like Abraham Lincoln, who was a self-taught scholar. He had read every book for miles around. And as he began to study, he became convinced from checking in the Bible that there was something in the gospel story. And he decided to give his heart to Christ. And he was converted, and a new peace came over him as he became a Christian. And his old deist friends began to point out to him all the old objections in the Bible that he himself had once used. And he said, "Well, if the Bible is really God's book, there cannot be contradictions in it, and I'm going to prove it or remain a deist still." And so he began to take the Bible, and he started in the first chapter or the first verse of Genesis. And he went no faster than he could understand each portion. And he laid aside all commentaries, and he just compared verse with verse with the aid of a commentary. And he began to spend many hours every day in his research. And as he progressed, he noticed that difficult passages of Scripture were explained by other passages. And he was enthralled at how accurately prophecy had been fulfilled in the past. And as he compared the prophecies in Daniel with the prophecies in Matthew and Revelation, he realized that the great tribulation had already passed. It was already over. The earthquake had come right on time. The dark day had come exactly at the right time. There was only one heavenly sign left before the beginning of the day of judgment, which he believed would be the second coming of Christ, and that was the falling of the stars. And so he began, as he studied the 2300-day prophecy in Daniel 8:14, which talks about the day of judgment. And he came to the conclusion that the day of judgment, which he thought would be the second coming, would occur around 1843 or 1844. But he was afraid to say anything about it until he had checked carefully. He didn't want to preach some type of fanaticism. And so most of the people in those days believed that they were arriving at 1,000 years of peace and prosperity before the coming of the Lord. But as he continued studying, he realized that that was wrong, and that the coming of Jesus was imminent and soon. He spent several years more diligently studying the Scripture to be sure that he could not possibly be wrong. And finally, he came to the conclusion that certainly the day of judgment was beginning in 1843 or 1844. And while he was about his business, he said, "There would be ringing in my ears this text. When I say to the wicked, 'O wicked man, you shall surely die,' and you do not speak to warn the wicked from his way, that wicked man shall die in his iniquity, but his blood will I require at your hand. Nevertheless, if you warn the wicked to turn from his way, and he does not turn from his way, he shall die in his iniquity, but you have delivered your soul." For 9 years he resisted the pleading of the Holy Spirit to go tell the world about the coming day of judgment. But finally, in 1831, he broke down and he said, "Okay, Lord, if somebody asks me to speak, I'll go and do it." For the first time, he felt great peace. and he was confident that nobody would ever ask a 50-year-old farmer to give a religious lecture. But within 30 minutes, there was a knock on his door with an invitation. And when the invitation came, he retreated back into the grove in his, behind his farm, and he was angry with himself for making a deal like that with God, and he was angry with God for answering, and he started fighting with the Lord, as we often do when the Lord asks us to do something we don't want to do. He said, "Lord, you know that I can't preach." But he had no peace. And finally he surrendered and said, "Lord, if you want me to preach, I will." And from that point on, calls and invitations came faster than he could respond. And thousands came to hear. And thousands of others derided and scoffed. However, wherever he went, a religious revival ensued. That was in 1831. And 2 years later, after that happened, the last of the tokens, the last of the signs listed by Jesus in Matthew 24 that would occur before his second advent occurred. The great falling of the stars occurred in November 13, 1833. R.M. Devens described it in his book entitled American Progress, or The Great Events of the Greatest Century. Here's the way he described it, quote, "The whole firmament over all the United States being then for hours in fiery commotion, no celestial phenomenon has ever occurred in this country which was viewed with such intense admiration by one class in the community or with so much dread and alarm by another. Never did rain fall much thicker than the meteors which fell toward the earth, east, west, north, south. It was the same. In a word, the whole heaven seemed in motion from 2 o'clock until broad daylight." Here's another account. It says, "It seemed as if the whole starry heavens had congregated at one point near the zenith and were simultaneously shooting forth with the velocity of lightning to every part of the horizon, and yet they are not exhausted. Thousands swiftly followed in the tracks of thousands as if created for the occasion." And here is one other by an astronomer from Boston. He computed, quote, "Not less than 240,000 meteors were at the same time visible above the horizon of Boston." And so thus was displayed the last of the signs that Jesus had given in Matthew 24 concerning his second advent, a direct fulfillment of Revelation 6:13, which says, "And the stars of heaven fell to the earth as a fig tree drops its late figs when it is shaken by a mighty wind." As a result of the falling of the stars, this gave a tremendous stimulus to people who were studying about the second advent. And thousands of people all over the world accepted the message of Christ's soon advent and began to prepare for the fact that they believed that Jesus was coming first in 1843 and then in 1844, but Jesus did not come. They were disappointed. It is known even today as the Great Disappointment. And people say, how could that be of God if they were disappointed? Well, now really, that very same type of thing happened to the 12 apostles when Jesus was crucified. The very same thing, they had a great disappointment too at the beginning of the Christian church. In fact, did you know that in the Bible that God predicted this great disappointment? Stay tuned in a moment. We'll read it from Bible prophecy.
We at Steps to Life are committed to helping you better understand the Bible and prepare for future events. We would like to send you a free study pack, including a study guide and audio cassette of today's subject, Your Last Night on Earth, and our new book entitled, The End of the World. When the last trumpet sounds and Christ comes to take His faithful people home, will you be among that group? Are you part of the final generation who will live to see Christ come? How can you know? If you are part of the final generation, what must you do to ensure that He is coming for you? The Bible talks about Earth's final generation and answers these questions for us. Call now for your free copy of our new book, The End of the World. Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH. When you call, ask for details on how to obtain your very own prophecy seminar binder to organize the studies you receive. Simply call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and make sure when you call that you ask for offer number 48. Call now.
Welcome back. We will see now that God predicted the very great disappointment that the Second Advent movement would experience in the 1840s. Look in your Bible in Revelation 10. It says, "And I saw still another mighty angel coming down from heaven, clothed with a cloud, and a rainbow was on his head. His face was like the sun, and his feet like pillars of fire. And he had a little book open in his hand, and he set his right foot on the sea and his left foot on the land." Verse 5, "And the angel whom I saw standing on the sea and on the land lifted up his hand to heaven, and swore by him who lives forever and ever, who created heaven and the things that are in it, the earth and the things that are in it, and the sea and the things that are in it, that there should be delay, that is, time, no longer. But in the days of the sounding of the seventh angel, when he is about to sound, the mystery of God would be finished, as he declared to his servants, the prophets." Notice, there's coming a time now when there's not going to be time anymore. People interpreted that to mean that that the world would end. What that means is that there would be no prophetic time anymore. There is no prophetic time anywhere in the Bible after 1844. There is no prophetic time. There is no time prophecy anywhere in the Bible that extends beyond 1844. That is the longest one that you can find in Daniel 8. Prophetic time extended until 1844, and then there was no prophetic time after that. There are no dates that anyone can set after 1844. There are only events. 1844 was the beginning of the day of judgment that would occur while the gospel was being preached on the earth, as you read in Revelation 14. But notice the great disappointment predicted when prophetic time would end in 1844. Notice what was going to happen to God's people. It says, "Then the voice which I heard," Revelation 10:8, "from heaven spoke to me again and said, Go, take the little book which is open in the hand of the angel who stands on the sea and on the earth. And I went to the angel and said to him, Give me the little book. And he said to me, Take and eat it, and it will make your stomach bitter, but it will be as sweet as honey in your mouth. And I took the little book out of the angel's hand and ate it, and it was as sweet as honey in my mouth. But when I had eaten it, my stomach became bitter." The belief that Jesus was coming soon to the Christian was as sweet as honey. But when they discovered that the prophecy actually taught that there was the beginning of the day of judgment and not the second coming, that news was very bitter because they were disappointed. And then they were told, Revelation 10:11, "And he said to me, You must prophesy again about many peoples," or concerning many peoples, nations, tongues, and kings. And so that was the beginning predicted. The beginning of the great Second Advent movement, when there would be time no longer, no more prophetic time, and they would be disappointed, but then they would have to prophesy again that the second coming of Christ was soon. It would occur at the end of the day of investigative judgment. The final movement in the world began with a disappointment, but it served a very real purpose. It sorted out the insincere and caused others to study more deeply the prophecies of God's Word. And so, that which was generated by these great signs, the great Second Advent movement, that generation was not to cease until all things had been fulfilled. The great Second Advent movement was what was generated by those signs that Jesus predicted in Matthew 24:29. The Second Advent movement is God's last remnant movement according to Bible prophecy, as you read in Revelation 12:17 or Revelation 14:12. People who are looking for the soon coming of Christ are not disappointed, are not discouraged by the fact that their movement began with a disappointment any more than the disciples were discouraged in Jesus' day that they were disappointed. It was part of prophecy. It was part of God's great plan, just as the proclamation of the disciples made on Sunday before the crucifixion was part of God's great plan and ended up in a disappointment for them. The Second Advent movement that was generated in the last part of the 18th and early part of the 19th centuries will still accomplish everything that it was intended to accomplish. Jesus has always had a called out group of people. The word church is from the Greek word ekklesia, which literally means called out. Jesus established his church on earth apart from human traditions. That was the foundation upon which the church was established. And sometimes it takes a disappointment and Bible study to get us away from human traditions. As Jesus established the apostolic church on the rock and purified it with a disappointment and then poured upon it the gifts of the Holy Spirit, So he has done in every particular with the last remnant movement that he established to finish his work on earth and prepare the way for his second coming. This movement Christ promised in Matthew 24 would be his last movement on earth and would not pass away until he had accomplished his purpose for it. And what is his purpose for it? It says in Ephesians 5:27 that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. Revelation 19:7-8, let us be glad and rejoice and give him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his wife has made herself ready. And to her it was granted to be arrayed in fine linen, clean and bright, for the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints. And oh friend, today that process is beginning to happen. Christ is purifying the Second Advent movement all over the world, and the message is beginning to go forth with power. And soon Jesus will come. The signs of the times in Bible prophecy all foretell that we are living in the very last days of earth's history. Today, Jesus is calling out a people to himself. And I have chosen. I want to be part of Christ's last movement. That is, those people that are waiting for Jesus to come, that the Bible says in Revelation 12:17 and Revelation 14:12, they keep the commandments of God. Now, they could be not spoken of as commandment keepers if they broke one. They keep the commandments of God, and they have the testimony of Jesus and the faith of Jesus. Today, Jesus is calling you. He's calling you to follow him step by step as he leads you away from the traditions of the world into a closer fellowship with him, and so that you're living by every word that proceeds out of his mouth. He wants to fill you with his Spirit and make you one of his remnant people. Higher than the highest human thought can reach is God's ideal for you. He loves you, and he has higher and happier plans for you than you have ever thought of or planned for yourself. The question is, will you choose to serve him today? The choice is yours. Will you choose to follow Jesus and be part of the group of people that is waiting for his soon return as described in Revelation 14:12? Will you be one of them? The choice is up to you.
We hope you have enjoyed today's prophecy seminar on your last night on earth. We would like to send you a free study pack, including a study guide and audio cassette of today's subject, as well as our new book entitled The End of the World. Simply call 1-800-THE-TRUTH. Is the world as we know it really going to come to an end? Is there any way we can know when it will happen? How is it going to happen? What do we have to look forward to? How do we know who the final generation will be? If he is coming back, what does he expect of those for whom he returns? Does the Bible really say anything about the people who are living when Christ returns? Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH now. And remember, when you call, ask for offer number 48. Tune in next week for The Two Marks. You won't want to miss this powerful message. If you are in the Wichita area and are looking for a church family, you are invited to join us for worship and fellowship every Saturday at 11 a.m.
Steps to Life.
We hope you have been as blessed by today's message as we have been in bringing it to you. We encourage you to contact us at Steps to Life Ministries with any questions or comments you might have.
Check 1-2. Check 1-2.
Don't forget to ask for today's free offer.
Ready in 5-4.
Steps to Life Ministries, preparing a people for the soon coming of Jesus Christ.
Welcome, friends.
He can change your life.